students across Oregon are back to school. At Portland Public Schools, Superintendent Guadalupe Guerrero marked the occasion by riding the school bus with kindergartners on their first day. Guerrero has been working to rebuild trust with parents after a series of setbacks for the district, including cost overruns on building projects and a scathing report about how the district handled allegations of sexual misconduct. Also tonight, the Democrat trying to flip Oregon's only Republican-held congressional district. Jamie McLeod Skinner is making a push to represent Central and Eastern Oregon in Congress. But can she unseat Republican Greg Walden? We'll meet her tonight. From KGW News, this is Straight Talk with Laurel Porter.
Hello and welcome to Straight Talk. I'm Laurel Porter. Another school year has just begun, and at Portland Public Schools, its leader, Superintendent Guadalupe Guerrero, is beginning his second year at the helm. We'll check in with the superintendent, find out what's new, and how the district plans to deal with a big cost overrun on the bond voters passed to remodel four schools. And then, later in the show, Oregon Congressman Greg Walden has a serious Democratic challenger in the November election. We'll meet Jamie McLeod Skinner and hear why she thinks she's the better choice to serve Oregon's 2nd District. First, welcome to my guest, Portland Public Schools Superintendent Guadalupe Guerrero. It's nice to have you back here on Straight Talk.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me back.
And the school is underway with nearly 50,000 students. How are you feeling about this school year?
I think we're feeling great about it. I think we had a relatively smooth and positive start of the school year.
And what's your number one goal this year?
Well, number one goal for the school year is that we stay on this forward path, that we get stronger both from a teaching and learning perspective, that we continue to deliver on the pledge we've made to make all of our schools high-quality places.
And you've made safety a high priority. What changes do you want to make when it comes to safety of schools?
Well, I think parents rightfully, you know, want to know and be confident that schools are safe places. So aside from delivering on our core mission to make sure there's high quality teaching and learning going on, we have to take all the measures that we can take to make sure school communities are safe and secure. And so we are taking a number of measures. Thankfully, our taxpayers and our bond set aside some resources for us to actually integrate some of those accommodations into facilities, cameras, intercoms, buzzers. Those things are important so that we don't have any outside intrusions, for instance.
And that will happen at all the schools?
Well, that's the goal, that over time, so we're working with, we're doing a security assessment to see what makes sense as we take a phased approach to look at some of these issues. And of course, when we talk student safety, work continues on changing out those water fixtures. So I think this school year, most all of our schools have common area fixtures that have been retested or replaced. So we're making progress.
Let's talk more about the water, because last time you were here was almost a year ago, and you started sort of amid an atmosphere of mistrust over the lead in the water problem and some other issues. And you told me at the time that was your number one goal, was to rebuild that trust with people in the district and take care of that lead in the water problem. As of May, we reported that the district was still spending hundreds of thousands of dollars on bottled water and on cups. Is that still going on? How many schools are still using bottled water?
Well, we still have some schools. We've made that an option for folks who still want to see water bottles available, in some cases because not all of the fixtures have yet been turned on or certified as safe. So we want to not restrict access to students' ability to hydrate. But I think a year ago when we spoke, I described sort of a month-by-month approach we were taking. So we've continued to make very steady progress, and we're now going to be moving into a phase starts to look at our classroom fixtures so that sinks and drinking faucets in the classroom actually can be retested.
When do you think the entire district will be lead free?
Well, I think even with an aggressive timeline that we have, I think we're still off a ways. It's thousands and thousands, literally, of water fixtures that would need to be tested and replaced in some cases. So that's gonna take a while, but it would be audacious for me to tell you that in this school year all of our classroom fixtures would be done, because that's gonna take some work.
And last time you were here, we were talking about that school bond, and even though there was this atmosphere of distrust, The voters really stepped up for the kids and put the kids mm-hmm. first, and they approved a $790 million mm-hmm. school bond. But now they learn there's this big cost overrun of $142 million, and so the district isn't going to be able to do what it says it was going to do with that amount of money. How does that make you feel about the confidence that voters must have in you and the district when you can't follow through?
Right. Well, I have to take every opportunity, first of all, to thank our taxpayers for their generosity. I take very seriously being a responsible public steward of those resources. And I think Portland Public Schools, like almost every other surrounding school district that has a large bond, has found cost containment to be a challenge. So while we're having an independent review and analysis done of, you know, how we've ended up where we are at this point and working in some cost efficiencies, the reality is that there are real cost escalations due to a booming construction and labor shortage, for instance, in the trades, that's going to allow us to build these buildings. So as time goes by, the cost of building these facilities gets escalated. Now, we're going to follow through over the long term on building those high schools that we pledged that we would build. And so our students certainly deserve that. We've started to talk about a long-term plan for doing that, and folks should continue to stay tuned for how we're going to deliver on that commitment.
I want to get more into that plan, but first let me ask you, it was reported that the board diverted some of that bond money to other schools that weren't in the original plan. Is that true, and why?
Well, I think an example of that is, part of this fall's, what made this school opening a milestone for us is we committed to opening two comprehensive middle schools and, Roseway Heights and Harriet Tubman. I think everybody's aware that there were concerns about the air quality. And so, yes, we spent some resources to make sure that safety would not be compromised for our students. And so expenses that maybe may have been unanticipated, like a pretty costly HVAC system, you can breathe the purest air in Portland inside the Harriet Tubman Middle School. So that's an example of some of the contingencies and flexibility that also need to be a part of any school bond measure.
There are a lot of people who feel, though, that the district lowballed the voters and sort mm-hmm. of misled them into what the real costs were to try to get that bond through. Is that true?
Well, I can't speak for, what prior leadership or administration may have done years ago, but I don't think there was any malintent or intent to mislead voters. I think that was the best understanding at the time. I think as we get into these projects and the true cost of building these facilities becomes more accurate, we just have to be transparent along the way with the public about what it's going to take to realize the dream that I think everybody wants to see come true.
One of the plans that's been floated is dividing up the money for Benson to the 2020 bond and then using some of that money. Isn't that a big risk to Benson that voters are going to step up again in 2020?
Well, you could frame it that way, or you could say that we're being pretty forthright about the progress we're making and continuing to have work sessions with the public so that they can understand what all the variables are. I think the public has seen what we've been able to produce in these facilities, and it's true. It may be that those later phases of some of the construction at Benson have to roll into a next proposed bond campaign, but we definitely want to see Benson built in the vision that the community is helping to define.
Talking about another high school, there are a lot of questions about the sudden departure of Wilson High School's principal, Brian Chittard. A lot of folks feel in the dark about that. It happened last week. He's since apologized for what he calls a lapse in judgment. Can you tell us what happened? A lot of people want to know.
Yeah, well, I really can't tell you because it's a personnel matter, but I have accepted his resignation. And all I'll say generally on the topic is we hold leadership in the school district to a high standard of professionalism and conduct.
Does that fuel the perception, though, that the district's not being transparent about
this?
Well,
we also have our employees who are entitled to some due process, and so we have to be respectful of those employee agreements as well. So,
citizens aren't going to hear any more about the Wilson High School.
Well, I
departure.
Think the resignation from the principal at Wilson High, that's been shared, that message, and so we're going to engage the community on identifying a dynamic new leader for Wilson High School.
Protesters showed up to a school board meeting last week to advocate that Portland Public Schools not evict a charter school at the end of the year that caters to black students. It's called Kairos PDX School. It's rented space at Humboldt Elementary for 2 years. And you've promised to better support students of color where the district has failed in the past. You and I have talked about that. What will you do in this case?
Well, I think I share the same goal that Cairo's as the school community has, and that's to make sure that we're better serving, in particular, our African-American students. And there's something special going on there. Any casual visitor to the school can see that there's a positive culture and climate and a real cultural affirmation, and I think that's an important ingredient. And while they're serving 170 students and they are in search of a long-term permanent home, we want to support them with that bridge facility need. Now, we also have to balance that with, as a school district, we also have our own space constraints. I think people saw and witnessed what happens when you don't have the flexibility of facilities to find homes for all of your programs, and I think that's what we were confronting last year. But we're in active conversation with the Cairo school community. I'm very optimistic that we're gonna find a win-win solution here, and I do want to begin to focus on a very clear strategy for how we're going to support the achievement and improved outcomes for the other 4,500 African-American students in the Portland Public Schools.
I think I read that Kairos wants to have 5 years, a five-year lease. Is that a possibility?
Well, we know even if they identified a facility today, with permitting and construction and development of any property, you would need at least a 2 to 3 year on-ramp. And so providing them with a possible option to take a little bit more time to situate themselves is something that we're discussing right now.
Education is front and center in the governor's race. Both candidates are talking about what they're going to do to improve education. What do you want to see the next governor do about education in Oregon?
Well, I definitely want to see leadership at the state level be very bold, be open to innovation. I think some of the general topics that no one would argue are critical to ensuring Oregon's student outcomes continue to move in the right direction, they need to include things like an investment in early education. We need to make investments in the instructional framework across all of our schools. These are conversations I'm having with my neighboring superintendents around the state. We know how to do this work, but that requires resources. And so if we want to put in those supports and interventions and really invest in our teachers, we want to have an ideal teacher-to-student class size ratio. These are the kinds of ingredients that go into making sure that Oregon schools are strong. So I'm looking forward to hearing, you know, both candidates really start to talk about some of those elements, and I hope that they engage the educational leaders of this state as they begin to form their ideas and plan.
We're having a debate here on October 9th, so if you were one of the panelists and you could ask one question of either candidate, what would you ask?
How are we going to ensure that the educational leaders of the state of Oregon have the adequate resources that the state legislature itself has defined in the quality education model are necessary to advance our schools are going to be there in the long term?
There's a movement right now to push high school start times to a later time to promote better learning, mental health, higher graduation rates. Right now, start times at 8:15, is that right? And Seattle's moved theirs to 8:45.
Yeah, I think this has been an interesting debate around the country. Anybody who has had teenagers in high school understands the difficulty. I certainly do in that regard too. And we know that just in development that our secondary aged students, you know, prefer a later start time. Now there's a lot of other conflict or variables that come with moving school hours because of transportation and athletics and after school extracurriculars. And so you have to take all those things into account. But I think the board and I would welcome, you know, taking a close look at, is there something we can do there to push out the start time for our high schools?
What do you think a time frame could be and when you could start that?
Well, we have a lot of ambitious goals that we want to take on this school year. We have some boundary reviews work. We have a vision development process that we're launching. We're articulating a strategic plan. We want to start to lay out a plan for addressing those opportunity gaps for our underserved students. And if along the way, taking on this conversation of school hours is one that we want to prioritize, we'll certainly do that.
Quick question about the baseball folks. They were talking about buying the PPS headquarters for a baseball stadium. Mm-hmm. Is there a chance that still could happen?
Well, I think that's the conversation we're still open to having. Ultimately, we're going to pursue any opportunity that's in the best interest of the school system, especially in the way that it will directly impact on all of our schools. So we're still
so
in
still
conversation.
On the table.
It's still on the table, and so we're welcoming sort of that conversation continuing.
Superintendent Guerrero, thank you for joining
you so
us
much.
Here on Straight Talk. Good luck in this school
And thank
school
you
year.
For making this a tradition. I hope you have me
I hope you come
next
back before
year
next
back
year. Thank you very much. And coming up next, she's been described as the most serious candidate that Greg Walden has faced in re-election. When we come back, we'll meet Democratic challenger Jamie McLeod Skinner. We're back in 2 minutes.